Hello and welcome to Analysis on TV 360 Nigeria. I am Onyi Adekunle. Now, in what can be considered a great news in the fight against the coronavirus pandemic, American pharmaceutical company Pfizer has announced a breakthrough in its COVID-19 vaccine. Despite early projections by researchers that a COVID-19 vaccine might only be 60 to 70% effective, Pfizer and partner BioNTech has exceeded expectations by announcing that their vaccine is 90% effective. Now, could this be the magic that would save the world? Let's get an expert opinion on this. I'm now being joined on the program by Dr. Nneabasi Ekanem, and he joins us via Skype. Dr. Ekanem, thank you very much for joining me on the program.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. So what do you make of this announcement?
Well, for me, it's a very great news. It's quite heartwarming that finally we are making progress towards eliminating this very great canker worm called COVID-19. Unfortunately, it is not just the right time for us to start rolling out the drums because we still have a long way to go. I really must say that. Out of about 43,500 volunteers that were tested with the vaccine, the analysis that has been made for just about 94 of those volunteers. That means that we still have a long way to go before we can categorically say that, wow, we have found a magic bullet. And even when we've done that, the big question would then be, how will this vaccine be distributed? Can Pfizer be able to produce the much needed vaccines in the volume or the doses that we need to go across the world? And even that is done, how then would African countries, the low and the middle income countries, fare when it comes to vaccine distribution? If you could recall in 1990, in the year 1990, when hepatitis B vaccine was discovered, it took about almost 4 or 5 years before countries like Nigeria could have access to those vaccines. As I speak to you now, the US has already made orders, the UK, Germany, these countries have already made orders for this new vaccine. Now, what would that be the situation for low and middle income countries? So these are some of the things that we need to bring to the table and discuss how we would fare even when we have found the vaccine for COVID-19. So for me, it's a concern. First of all, I'm happy, and I trust that this is going to be the last port of call when it comes to the vaccine for COVID-19. But the real question that is staring in our faces is, how would countries like Nigeria be able to afford this vaccine for its own citizens? So I think this is what we need to really worry about.
I mean, Dr. Ekanem, I'm going to take you up later on the show, on the program, when we talk about the distribution. But right now, you said earlier that it's too early to rejoice over this or to roll out the drums. That's in your words now. But for countries, we've seen in Europe, a second wave is already emerging. Countries are having to reimpose lockdowns. When you say it's too early to rejoice, those countries will disagree with you, don't you think?
Well, the truth is that if you could recall what happened sometime in 1945, the thalidomide era, after the World War, women who were pregnant, were found to be vomiting a lot, and that affected their pregnancy. Some of them got to lose those pregnancies. So the world was looking for an antiemetic that can help to solve this problem. At a point, we were able to find thalidomide. But what happened? People, all the pregnant women who took this thalidomide, which was distributed in duress, all the women that took it end up giving birth to children with phocomania, without legs and hands. We don't want to repeat this again. And that's why safety concerns is a very critical step when it comes to vaccine development. So right now, we have passed the stage of efficacy. We've seen that it's 90% efficacious, but we must also address the safety concerns. Like I said, out of the 43,500, just 94 volunteers have been evaluated already. We cannot base our judgment on this. So we have to wait until we have been able to evaluate more results, and then we can be able to come up with facts to say that, look, We have gotten the vaccine. But not until then, we cannot. And I will say again, we cannot just be in a hurry to start jubilating. That's just the fact about it.
And of course, the company said that the efficacy rate, which is higher than 90% at 70 days after the second dose, meaning that protection is achieved 28 days after a person begins vaccination. Please just help us make sense of that. What exactly does that mean?
Okay, the truth is this, you know, vaccines actually, what they do is they help to activate the immune cells, particularly the T cells of the immune system. And these cells help to, eliminate the real virus itself when a person gets in contact with this virus through a process known as phagocytosis. The truth is that when a person takes the vaccine, it takes a period of time for the vaccine to actually activate the antibodies in the immune system. Mm-hmm. Now, for this virus, it will take some days, like the company has even stated, for us to have this. That means between when the vaccine was taken to that period of time, the patient or the individuals can still be at risk of the virus. But as long as the second dose has been taken, the individual is immune to the virus. Now, the question would be, how long would it now take people to be able to get immune to the virus? Can somebody be exposed to the virus within this period of time? The truth about it is that for now, this is the best that we can get. We expect that probably in the coming years, we might be able to get something that will give us that immunity within a shorter period of time. But with this, I think to an extent, for me, I'm quite comfortable with this.
And the company says it plans to seek emergency use authorization, which would be possible towards the end of this month. What exactly is the next step from there?
For a pandemic that has killed, you know, a lot of people and had left a lot of millions of people, you know, infected. Well, we may not be able to go through all the critical stages of the clinical trials. So that means that the company would rather seek an approval from the Food Drug Administration of the U.S., which is actually the organization that is in charge of authorizing such the use of such a medication. So the vaccine can be made available even if it hasn't gone through all the stages of trials. It can be made available so that it can be used on emergency for people who are already at serious risk of the virus. So for me, I think it's a necessity. We can't just wait until probably we have gone through all the phases, because this pandemic is killing. And like you have said, the second wave is already it's already in place in some countries. That means there is an urgent need for us to roll out this vaccine to see how we can save millions of lives from going down because of this COVID-19. So with authorization from FDA, we should be able to have the first batch of the doses coming in by the end of December.
And then the World Health Organization said that there are at least 10 vaccine candidates in late-stage trials. And recently, Brazil had to halt trials of a particular vaccine, Chinese COVID-19 vaccine, that's Sinovac, after an adverse incident involving a volunteer recipient. Now, is this common? Is it common for incidents like this to occur?
Yes, and that is the reason why I stressed safety concerns, okay? So we have a lot of vaccine candidates, right, for COVID-19. But you see, one of the main issues with vaccines is safety. So the good thing about this vaccine is that it is safe. It is very, very safe. As a matter of fact, since it has been used, since it has been tried, there has not been even a single case of safety concerns. But like the Chinese vaccine actually had issues. We saw a lot of adverse reactions with some of the subjects that were exposed to the vaccine. And because of that, it had to be halted. As a principle, any vaccine that has safety concerns must be halted immediately and cannot be continued. The only ones that can be continued are actually those without safety concern. Because while you want to save people from COVID-19, You do not want to expose them to more dangerous medical conditions. So that's special as it is.
All right, Dr. Ekanem, let me take you back now to the concerns you raised earlier about distribution or availability of these vaccines. And I'm trying to just imagine a picture here where underdeveloped or developed countries, or developing countries rather, are trying to struggle to get these vaccines. And how damaging can that be?
Well, it's a serious concern because when it comes to vaccination like this, a company has put in so much and want to make so much from the sales of those vaccines. Unfortunately, as you know, Nigeria belongs to the low and the middle income countries. And for such countries, it might be difficult for you to whisk economic powers with the world powers like Germany, like US, UK, sure. And Canada. So for us, it's a big challenge. But I believe that with Gavi, that is the Global Vaccine Alliance, working closely with the World Trade Organization, we can be able to come, to an agreement, have a compromise with the company that some doses should be sent to the African countries, especially the low and middle income countries, while not neglecting those who have already placed orders. That way we can ensure equity, we can ensure that everyone have access to the vaccine. Mm. We know that not everyone will have access to the vaccine now, but at least there should be an equity in terms of distribution of this vaccine across the world. So that is exactly what we are hoping for. And we are hoping that with Gavi, with World Trade Organization, we should be able to achieve this.
All right, Doctor, please, let's just take a pause here. And when we return, we'll continue this conversation. We'll go on a short break now. And Dr. Ekanem is still standing by to continue the discussion with us.
All right.
Welcome back to the program. If you're just joining us, we're still discussing issues regarding the COVID-19 pandemic, particularly the COVID-19 vaccine, which has been announced by American pharmaceutical company Pfizer to have a 90% effect on patients, volunteer recipients who have taken it. But we still have Dr. Nneabase Ekanem, who is standing by on the program. Thank you, Dr. Ekanem, for staying with us on the program. Now, let's take it now down to Nigeria. We're gradually seeing the cases of COVID-19 spike in the country, which health authorities say could lead to a second wave of the pandemic. Are you worried that we may be reversing our previous gains?
Yes, I am actually worried. And the truth is that from the reports that we have even received, personally, I've received reports from a lot of my colleagues who are attending to patients. There has been a rise in the cases of COVID-19 in Lagos and other parts of Nigeria. We might actually be looking at a second wave, if not now, but towards the Harmattan season. But I would say that, of course, the uprising in recent times, and of course, the political elections, the campaign, and all of that could have been a strong contributor to this. The rise in the cases of the COVID-19 pandemic in Nigeria. But for me, I feel that it is now time for us to reenact the message. We need to reintroduce the message to the public. I know for many Nigerians, we feel that COVID-19 is gone. I've actually had interaction with a lot of people who told me, why are you still putting on your mask? The virus is gone. So we need to intimate people, tell them that, look, we still have the virus around. As a matter of fact, the cases are increasing. And let us see how we can convince the people. It's about disease risk communication, letting people know that, look, fine, we were able to get to a point whereby we had a plateau. We even had declining cases of the virus. But now the virus, the pandemic has gone up again. And that we need to adhere to the precautionary measures as far as COVID-19 prevention is concerned. Our leaders have to also set an example. We need to see them on their mask. We need to see more or less a public-private partnership. We need to see some collaboration where people come in and support. the public towards ensuring that the message gets to the grassroots and everybody is working together towards ensuring that we should try as much as possible to get the pandemic done with. Now, the other thing we need to address is that now that Nigerians have heard that, okay, there is a vaccine in the works and it's quite promising, a lot of Nigerians would lose their guard. Mm-hmm. And say, after all, the vaccine is almost here. We need to also let people know that vaccine development and vaccine deployment, especially to low and middle income countries, is not that easy. That it might take a while. So that means in the meantime, we still need to obey the social distancing rule. We need to still have our hands sanitized, and we also need to have our face mask so that we can protect ourselves from this ravaging virus. We need to send this message out. Mm. We need to ensure that people understand it and people adhere to this message to the letter.
But doctor, let me just put you on the spot here. Do you see a second lockdown coming?
Well, I'm seeing that coming, but I would really want to advise against it. I would really, in the strongest possible term, I think what we should do now is let us talk to ourselves. Let us encourage ourselves to adhere to the simple instructions. Because, you see, we have still not recovered from the effect of the first lockdown.
Very
and
true.
With the level of hardship, I must say categorically, if we go on a second lockdown, instead of us having a lockdown, we may have a chaos, we may have a catastrophe, we may have a serious unrest in the country. So I think we need to be diplomatic in our approach towards the second wave of COVID-19. We should be able to, as a nation, start implementing some of those strategies at the port of entries, both the land, the sea, and the air, port of entries. We need to make sure that we increase disease surveillance so that we avoid imported cases of COVID-19. We also need to ensure that we strengthen our healthcare system, to be able to detect and, quarantine suspected cases. We also need to strengthen our contact tracing modalities. So we need to put all these modalities in place. And of course, we should have this public-private partnership where we have discussion with the private sector. How can we collaborate together? How can we collaborate in terms of resources to ensure that we take care of Nigerians in this trying period? We also have to bring in the civil society organizations. These are community-based organizations that have that closer relationship with the grassroots. We need to make sure that we engage them adequately so that they can help us educate the grassroots so that together we can work hand in hand to ensure that we protect ourselves from this COVID-19. But we shouldn't think in the direction of another lockdown, because if we have another lockdown, I tell you, with what I'm seeing out there, we might be having a serious unrest. And of course, you know what that would mean to the COVID-19 pandemic itself. So I see it coming, but I see a way that we can prevent it. That's what I can say.
Indeed, I quite agree with you. But away from COVID-19 now, let's look at this developing story about deaths linked to yellow fever. I believe in Delta, there are also other states, Enugu, and I believe two other states. Is this something that should raise concerns at this time?
Oh, yes. I have been following the story and I've been discussing with some of the epidemiologists in these states. And, the reason for this is not far-fetched. Yellow fever is one of those vaccine-preventable diseases. And as a rule, there's always what we call a routine vaccination that is done on a yearly basis, especially in places that were not captured in the previous vaccination. That is what we call catch-up vaccination. Unfortunately, that since the beginning of the COVID-19 in February 27, 2020, up until today, there has been some kind of skeletal services in the healthcare sector, because more healthcare workers have been deployed to tackle the scourge of COVID-19 at the detriment of providing vaccination services for against yellow fever amongst other diseases. So it's not unexpected to see an outbreak of diseases like yellow fever. But I think for me, this is a wake-up call for us to pay more attention to making sure that we strengthen vaccination coverage in especially those states where the outbreak has already begun, and of course other states, because they are also at risk. we should be able to bring in more health workers, you know, so that we can be able to have enough workforce, enough manpower to take care of vaccination while we are still fighting COVID-19. So if we can be, if we are able to do that, then to an extent we'll be able to handle this outbreak, and we'll be able to curtail the number of deaths that are going to be resulting from this yellow fever. So it's expected. It's not just yellow fever. There are many other diseases like meningitis that we have left unattended to because of the COVID-19. We as a nation need to pay attention to that. So we need to bring in more people so that we can be able to handle this pandemic, amongst other things that we need to handle in the healthcare system. So I think for me, that's the way out for us to be able to tackle the outbreak of yellow fever in these states.
All right, Dr. Nyabasi Ekanem, thank you very much for sharing your insights with us on the program. And I believe what you are trying to say in closing would be we need the importance of localizing our response to public health issues in Nigeria. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us on the program.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
That's it on the program, on this episode of the program. We thank you so much for watching. I'll see you again next time. Bye-bye.